Happy to welcome Dagmar Herzog, Distinguished Professor of History at the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, to our series of Max Weber lectures, interviews which are accompanying our video podcast of our prestigious Max Weber lectures. So Dagmar, very welcome, and we're very pleased to have you here.
Thank you so much.
So you gave a fascinating talk yesterday, which was in many ways the perfect Weber lecture, as it had historians and economists alike eagerly listening. The talk told a story of how the reemergence of psychoanalysis in Germany in the late 1960s can be linked to the German New Left movement, despite the popular success of psychoanalysis having at least partially been possible only because of figures such as Konrad Lorenz. So my question I was kind of marveling about was, how did you develop this specific focus, and in how does it kind of stand in relation to your story of becoming a historian of post-war Germany and the history of sexuality?
Okay, so this is a long answer, but all my academic life, since I was in graduate school and wrote my dissertation on the formats, the pre-March period, the 1840s in Baden, in the southwest corner of Germany, when I wrote about the rise of a religious right, in that case of ultramontane Catholics, and how disoriented they made liberals at the beginning of the emergence of the era of mass democracy. Until then, through Sex After Fascism, which is a book about 20th century German sexual politics, but also the politics of post-Holocaust memory, and then working on the United States, on the evangelicals, and then doing a history of sexuality, Europe in the 20th century, 25 countries, 100 years. In all these cases, I was instinctively drawn to trying to understand why the right is so successful, and why liberals or leftists are always awkwardly responding and don't have the winning side. So already in the 1840s, liberals think that they're triumphing, but suddenly there's a religious right that uses anti-Semitic argumentation and sexual innuendo to mobilize mass popular appeal against the liberals. Already then in the 20th century, the Nazis offer a combination of repressiveness but also sexual incitement in order to become popular. You know, whether the evangelicals in the United States in the 1990s promise pleasure from their more restrictive sexual recommendations. So in every case, I was curious about the success of the right, and that's when I first started reading psychoanalytic texts that try to explain why fascism is appealing and why right-wing politics in general are appealing. And there are many different psychoanalytic theories about that. So some people ask the question of why do human beings want to submit to authority? But there's also a vast literature about pleasure and cruelty, and a pleasure in a sense of superiority. And depending what case of fascism they're looking at, they emphasize different aspects of it, right? But that, of course, was one big strand. I was also really interested in theories of anti-Semitism. Why is it the Jews are singled out for hatred? Why are the disabled or the Roma or homosexual men singled out for hatred? And there are psychoanalytic explanations for that. So that was one big strand. And the other strand had to do with the growing role of the history of sexuality in my work, which I didn't expect at all. But, you know, I set out to write about the 1840s, actually about the religious dissenting movement, Christian dissenting movement, and the role of women. Very much, you know, 1840s emergence of an early feminist movement. And when I got into the archives, I discovered that it was really a men's rights movement, and it was about men's rights to have marriage with whatever woman they chose across the Catholic Protestant boundary. Priests would be allowed to marry. It was really a sexual movement. The liberals loved them. Liberals became the friends of Jewish rights because they were so excited about this Christian dissenting movement that had lost its political rights that they wanted to encourage the separation of church and state that they'd never cared about before. So suddenly, I was interested in the ways in which desire and emotion works in politics. And sex sort of emerged in the context of the archival work, not because I'd gone looking for it. And I was very surprised then when I turned to my second book, which was intended as a history of post-Holocaust, post-Nazi memory politics. And the first grant applications I wrote were about these innocent American questions. Why was it the lesson of the Third Reich was not the need for anti-racism, but rather, oh, we should re-Christianize German society, or oh, we need to be anti-militarist, or oh, we need to be anti-authoritarian. Every possible lesson except for anti-racism. And then when I started to read the primary sources for the immediate post-war period and for then the 60s, what I noticed was that everyone was talking about sex. Again, I hadn't gone looking for it, but the sources were full. And in the immediate post-Nazi period, there was an argument that the Nazis had been wildly pro-sex, but the new left Make Love Not War generation thought that the Nazis were terribly sexually repressive. And I thought, well, would the real Third Reich please stand up? Which is it? And in fact, why is the fight about the lessons of Nazism carried out in the realm of sex at all? So that then strengthened my interest in history of sexuality, but always interwoven with other aspects. Mm-hmm. And so that was another driving force that made me really interested in the intricacies of conflicting desires, and the power of the unconscious, and the power of fantasy to drive politics. And those were another set of reasons that made psychoanalysis seem like I should learn something about it.
Okay. And then you found that it actually emerges not necessarily just in the conservative side, but also on the...
Yeah, that's right. So one of the things when I started doing the research on a book about post-World War II Freudianism, right? Freud dies in 39. Mm-hmm. The Nazis have driven even more psychoanalysts, either because they're leftist or because they're Jewish, into diasporic exile. So they're all over the world, especially in the United States and England, but also in France, but also in Latin America, but also in Southeast Asia. There are many, many places where psychoanalysis is growing in the post-war period, and it has its greatest public and medical triumph in the United States from about 1945 to 1970. During Cold War, height of the Cold War, in the United States, psychoanalysis is very popular. It's very strong in medical circles, it makes great collaboration with the Christian churches, and it also infuses political protest movements, but also the social sciences, anthropology, sociology. It's a powerful framework for thinking. Whereas in post-war continental Europe, there is much more hesitation and ongoing resistance to psychoanalysis, especially in Germany, where it was associated with Jewishness and sex-obsessedness and dirtiness and so on. But it is the new left trying to recover the radical Jewish heritage of the early 20th century that wants to recover Freud also. Mm-hmm. And so I was very interested in these two very different Freuds, that Freud can be seen also in France, where Lacan is the most powerful representative. Mm-hmm. The new left also takes up leftist versions of Lacanianism then as part of explaining, well, why their parents were subordinate to authority, mm-hmm. trying to explain the new fascism that the Cold War is producing, whether it's in Greece or in Chile or in Indonesia, trying once again to understand the Vietnam War. So there is a big push then to make psychoanalysis useful both for personal healing and for political criticism, just at the moment when it's dying in the United States, or just being transformed into more of a niche and not as powerful culturally as it used to be. Mm.
So, generally, your work has a tremendous public appeal. How does that impact on the way you do research?
Well, I also get a lot of public hostility, so it's not just appeal. When I wrote about the United States and the rise of the religious right in the 1990s, doing sort of the sex work for the Republican Party, the abstinence education movement, the anti-homosexual, anti-abortion movements, all those things that were successful in part because they promised pleasure, because they played on people's most intimate anxieties about partnership and passion, because they managed to secularize their message and make it all about mental health. I would say that when I was on evangelical radio shows, it was okay, because we could talk about what does Jesus want and what does the Bible say. But with right-wing radio shock jocks, it was pretty scary and intense to be an object of aggression. And also in bookstores, I experienced, you know, just speaking to the general public rather than an academic audience, I experienced people's yearnings and confusions about the rollback in sexual rights that the Bush administration had produced, mm-hmm. and people's confusions about premarital sex, and people's confusions about condom programs in Africa, and people's confusions about sort of the meaning of sexuality in their lives. And that confusion and yearning that they had often manifested as aggression. So I would say it's not just appeal. I think that it was an interesting experience to organize my book on the subject, trying to explain the success of the right. But I think that many liberals and Democrats, whether they were journalists or politicians, also felt insulted, because it's very hard to courageously defend sexual rights. Mm-hmm. It's constant. We can sort of defend gay rights, that's become, that's a great achievement of the gay rights movement, that that's become something that politicians, also some Republicans now, can feel strongly about. But it's gotten ever more difficult to defend abortion rights. It's gotten very difficult to defend the rights of poor women to access contraception through subsidized Planned Parenthood. There are many ways in which it's gotten hard to defend comprehensive sex education. I think that liberals have been deeply intimidated, and they all experience the incursion and closing down of what's speakable. And so I thought a lot about that. I think it's not just appeal. I think also liberals were upset in the sense that I was saying, look, why is it so hard to defend sexual rights?
So in that vein, then, with the new work, because the presentation you gave us yesterday is relatively new. You haven't given it to that many people yet,
right.
This talk. What kind of reactions are you expecting to this more sort of psychoanalysis-focused work?
Well, I think in the United States, because we are living in the era of neuroscience and of biochemical treatments for depression and anxiety, and an era in which psychoanalysis is mostly smiled upon or dismissed, it's really a properly historical topic. So it's more a matter of curiosity. Oh, right, there was a time when Freud was really important. It's not as pressing in contemporary terms. On the other hand, I think that the themes that are raised, whether human nature is innately aggressive or not, are themes that people need to continue to talk about.
Okay. So now, the breadth of your sources in your work, it's impressive.
Don't look at my study, there are papers piled everywhere.
Exactly. How do you go about collecting your sources and collating them into a sort of coherent narrative?
With difficulty.
And how... this is a question that anthropologists, for instance, also kind of consider. How do you know that you have enough material and it's time to go and sit down and write?
Right. I always think there's a dialectic between the collecting and the writing it up, because when you start trying to write based on the sources you already have, then you realize, oh, wait a minute, I don't know why that happened, and then you have to get more material. So I actually think that you can't just collect and collect and then sit and write. It doesn't work that way. In fact, I think there's a third activity, which is to present. Because there are things that people have said to me now over the last 24 hours that I will think, oh, I need to go research that more, and I'll have to fill that in. That'll be useful for me. I collect a frightening amount of stuff, and I have yet to... I do some of my marking up sources electronically now, but mostly I want the paper, and I mark it with different colors, and so on. So I'm a bad paper user. There's many pieces of paper. And for the psychoanalysis project, I have conducted interviews on both sides of the Atlantic with practicing psychoanalysts or with people who were very involved in the movement to make psychoanalysis be useful for cultural criticism. I have done work in many different libraries, also medical libraries, where there are transcripts of interviews that were conducted in prior decades. Yeah, there's a massive collection at the Library of Congress in Washington that was done by a man named Kurt Eisler, where he interviewed in the early 50s everyone who had personally known Freud. It's phenomenal research. They just opened the records 2 years ago. So I'm, in some cases, the first person to read some of them, and they're amazing. In terms of the fact that they both talk about life in the 1920s and 30s and about the fate of psychoanalysis in the 50s in their moments, so you can lead them on two different levels, right? And then, of course, I have all kinds of psychoanalytic published sources, but also all kinds of private correspondence, but also popular dissemination, or, you know, Christian theologians weighing in, or journalists weighing in, and so on. So it's a lot, and I usually don't know how to construct a story out of a piece of it until I start imagining giving it as a talk.
Okay, so this kind of also leads on to the sort of to the next question that myself and also a few of my colleagues were wondering. How does one, thinking about your last book, which is this relatively, this study on basically 100 years, multiple national contexts,
right,
and trying to write a history of sexuality across this extreme big span. How does one start or conceive of that as a book in the end?
I got an assignment. I mean, I basically spoke out of Sex After Fascism in 2005 in Cambridge, England, and somebody in the audience told the editors at Cambridge that they should hire me to write a history of sexuality in Europe in the 20th century. And so I signed a contract in 2005. And then I actually delayed writing that book because I wrote the book on the American religious right. And that was actually really helpful for two reasons that I delayed. One is that I had a whole new set of research questions by studying the sort of postmodern conservatives. And because it got me the interesting question, what causes a culture to go sexually liberal, or what causes it to go sexually conservative, and what factors contribute? Is it public protests in the streets? Is it campaigns? Is it a single charismatic individual? How much do transnational influences matter? All those comparativist questions were things that I was unable to bring to the European project, 25 countries approximately. And the other thing that was really wonderful was that in those few years that I was doing the American thing, a lot more was published by sociologists, anthropologists, and historians about Eastern Europe. So I had more that I could draw on. It's definitely an imbalanced book in the sense that there is more on the West just because there's more material and we know more. We know a fair amount about the East in its final decades and then its immediate aftermath. We don't know very much at all about the intricacies of contraceptive use or homosexuality or pornography or any of these sort of more intimate, you know, just daily life things for the 50s and 60s in many of the Eastern European countries. But we know a little bit more than we would have a few years earlier. So I was able to integrate that. And how I did it was I just collected like a maniac on every country imaginable, everything I could find, primary sources and secondary sources in every language that I can read and that my graduate students can read. So I have a graduate student who reads Polish, and he was lovely in reading something in 1912 from Warsaw about methods of abortion at that time. You know, and then I have a Hungarian graduate student and a Romanian and whatever, and in every case, you know, an Italian and a Spanish, and in every case I was then able to utilize some special primary source that hasn't been included in anybody's secondary scholarship, whether it was about prostitution or, you know, whatever the topic was. Suddenly I had this little bit that could be added in. And then I first had, it's always an assignment that sort of focuses me. I had a request from the American Historical Review to do a review essay as part of a forum where someone did a review essay on Africa, somebody on Asia, someone on the Middle East, someone in the United States, and I was asked to do Europe, explain the evolution of the field of the history of sexuality. So suddenly I had my many trays of papers, and I did the boring thing of actually typing up every one of my sources, secondary or primary, so I would know what I had in each of my files, Austria, Belgium, you know, you can do the alphabet just as well as me. and then I looked at that. It was like a 25-page single-space document after I typed it all up, and I thought, because I wrote down the year of the primary sources and secondary, and I started to see the patterns. And I thought, oh, the very first move, sort of after Foucault wrote The History of Sexuality in the late 70s and so on, is to do something that's archaeological. What the hell happened in X time on X topic in X place? That's the very first step. Then there was another step that happened, which was integrationist, in the sense that a number of really important books came out that said, you can't understand the Russian Revolution if you don't think about sex. You can't understand the French, the Enlightenment, the Industrial, the take your pick, World War II, doesn't matter, pick an agreed upon big topic, and you will understand it more profoundly if you pay attention to sex. So that was another big move. And then ultimately, by the 90s, there was enough available that people could start to ask comparativist questions. So that's, I think, the third stage. So that we asked I think it was the classic historian's questions of causation, periodization, and interpretation could be asked with the case study of sex, because there was enough to ask it with. So in some countries, in fact, it's a movement that changes the law, and in other cases, the law changes, and then there's a movement, because suddenly it's safe to be in the streets and declare who you are. That it really depends. And in some cases, transnational pressures matter tremendously. That was increasingly true the closer you got to the present. Romania changed its laws on homosexuality because it wanted to get into the EU. You know, that's had nothing to do with popular opinion. So those are the kinds of things that then kept me interested intellectually when I was writing up the story.
So now, in preparing the interview, I went onto your CUNY website, and I saw in one of your works in progress is entitled The Death of God in the 20th Century.
Right.
Would you give me a little glimpse of what you're planning on doing with this exciting title?
What happened is that sometimes websites don't get updated on purpose. So that was initially, I had actually collected a huge amount of material because I'd written an article in 2003 or so when I was part of a conference about the persistence of religion in the modern world.
Yeah.
And it was at the University of Chicago, Michael Geyer, Hartmut Lehmann, and a bunch of amazing scholars, and it turned into a collection. And for that, the piece that I did was about the Death of God movement in the 1960s, and which is a transnational movement. It was in Germany, in England, in the United States especially. And what I discovered when I did the research is that, in fact, it wasn't about the death of God at all. It was actually about an argument about the nature of God.
Mm-hmm.
So really the argument was that this, and I said you weren't in the meeting this morning, but I was giving an explanation. There was a huge fight about what is secularity and what is religiosity, what is faith.
Mm-hmm.
Please, dear God, please let me pass this exam. Or, you know, please don't let this plane crash or whatever. This kind of give me Jesus kind of prayer was perceived of as superficial, magical thinking, and not true faith. And on the other hand, the idea of fighting on behalf of social justice, living in community, being as human as you can be, was perceived of as more faith-filled and more what God initially wanted. So I was fascinated to learn that it wasn't an atheist movement.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was really interested to learn how it was actually in some ways overlapping with what then became a very powerful movement called liberation theology,
mm-hmm.
which had its roots in, among Catholic Marxist interested people in Latin America, but also was taken up in Europe and in the United States, and I think really rescued Christianity's moral reputation
mm-hmm.
in the 1960s and 70s, detaching Christianity from its defense of the status quo and making it be about being in solidarity with the suffering. So I was really interested in that overlap, and I wrote that piece mostly about Germany, and then I thought, oh, I want to do the comparison for England and France and the United States, so I collected an enormous amount of material.
Mm-hmm.
But ultimately, for a complicated set of other reasons, it ended up getting derailed into what I talked about this morning, which had to do with the theological arguments about disability and abortion rights.
Mm-hmm.
So I have all that material as context, and maybe someday I can do something with it. But it ended up transmogrifying into another project.
Okay, great.
All right.
Well, thank you very much for taking the time.
Thank you.
And-